The stamp we issue here today commemorates the accomplishments of the flights of Eagle and of Columbia. The stamp is an airmail stamp. It depicts mankind's John Lee, and it was made from a die which accompanied Eagle to the moon. The commemorative stamp is, in a very real way, an instrument of the American people. It is a means by which they pay homage to those events and to those men whom it honors.
What started out in 1847 as prepayment certificates for delivery of mail have become our nation's calling cards. A gallery in miniature of the people, events, and ideas important to our nation. See in stamps a textbook of changing styles of art. Artists and craftsmen. The subjects for stamps and the artists to visualize them are selected by a stamp advisory committee, experts in art, history, printing, and philately. Final selection and approval of a design is made by the Postmaster General. Engraving, printing, and processing are done by the Bureau of Engraving and Printing. From the actual size photographic model, the engraver starts his dies. These will be the source of the single handmade die proof and the millions or billions of copies. Are developed. The moon landing stamp requires 7 colors. But to compensate for depth of engraving and for the speed of presses during mass production, many samples with slight color variations are prepared. A separate die is made for each plate used on a press. Here, one die is made for the 3 colors to be engraved, and one die for each of the 4 colors to be lithographed. Lithographic proof ready, all that's needed are the engraved colors to bring the stamp to life. Precision-made miniature artwork is ready for mass production. First, multiple impression plates for the presses. To make the engraving plates, the process requires a series of hardenings in hot cyanide and transfers of impression. Transfer is performed by siderography, writing on iron. No gauges, no meters. Experience gives the operator the right feel of the wheel and the plate. For these multicolor stamps, the steel plate serves as a reproducing master. In a series of electrolytic platings, nickel-based chrome-covered press plates are produced. Each of these plates is etched by pantograph, with its own plate number at each corner. All sheets printed from this plate carry this plate number. On the press, the plate is inked by inking rollers, one roller for each color. Each roller is cut to put its color on the proper sections of the plate, and nowhere else. With each turn, the moon landing plate is inked with three colors. The plate's surface is wiped off, and the ink in the engraved lines is picked up by the paper, precisely overprinting the lithographic colors. Many stamps are printed entirely by steel engraving. Using rolls of paper instead of sheets, the press in one pass puts on the ink and dries it. Puts gum on the back and dries it. Puts an invisible phosphor coating on the front and dries it. The phosphor coating is for automatic sorting and canceling of letters. Even though only one ink is used, the engraving produces differences of shading, gives a sense of three dimensions. Perforating and cutting require precision too. For the kinds of stamps we've seen so far, a separate operation is required. There's a special press that prints as many as 9 colors from engraved plates and inking rollers. It gums the back, coats the front, inspects each color and coating. It perforates the roll and cuts it into sheets. It does all this in one pass of the paper. It's the only press of its kind, anywhere. The sheets are examined and counted by hand, twice. They're prepared for sale as panes or books. Some stamps wind up as coils. In the United States each year, more than 28 billion stamps are sold. Most of them are used mail. but stamp collectors buy enough to give the philatelic section of the Postal Service a profit every year. A stamp is a stamp is a stamp. Or is it much more? Not to be. That is the question.